guys, happy lunch was so much fun today.
Yeah, yeah, it was so good.
It was a lot of fun.
Wow, Joe, where did you get this from? It's so beautiful.
I think I got it from Fab India.
But yeah, it's from Punjab, I
think. Yeah, I think it's called Fitkari.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Wow, look at it.
So even hers is really pretty. Yeah. Nimita, where did you get this from?
This is Banarasi.
That's very pretty. Yeah.
I'm wearing block print.
Oh, wait. I think design students in our school do that,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I've seen them
do it for hours.
Yeah, yeah, guys.
It takes so much effort.
Guys, I wonder if like this takes so much time, how much time would the others take?
Yeah. Yeah.
We should find out.
We should find out. Let's go to the library. Yeah.
Humans have an innate desire to express their thoughts, imagination, feelings, and ideas through various art forms and design. This craving for artistic expression, be it on the walls of a cave or on a woven silk adorned by beautiful women, makes us intrinsically human. The purpose of art is expression which cannot be reproduced, whereas design is deeply rooted in the indigenous craftwork. Indian design is nothing but inspired from the craft practices that one can witness changing from village to village. Design has sufficed the human need for beauty in daily life. From something as simple as coasters to designer clothes at fashion shows, its traces are found as far as the eye can see. An Indian home is rich in culture, stemming from every string in an embroidery pattern and every print painstakingly transferred through a wooden block. Steeped in history and religion, the crafts of India are diverse, and each state reflects the influence of different empires that have found their roots in the culture and tradition within rural communities. Each region of India is endowed with unique handicrafts that have evolved through the generations, constantly re-innovating to continue to give each craft a contemporary look while preserving their rich traditions. Art and design bring out the exquisite beauty in the form of textile and craft. The act of handcrafting an object is to suffice a daily chore, to pacify a need of faith, or perhaps to hone the dexterity of a pair of hands. This act of crafting is but the most potent proof of the civilness within any civilization. Today, the Priyasi class of Vellum Girls School will present to you our virtual exhibition on traditional forms of textile and crafts in India.
Stretching from the hilly expanses of Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh down to the fertile plains of Haryana and Punjab, all the way across the expanse of the Thar Desert in Rajasthan, northern India may as well be called the cultural heart of the country. It is so richly blessed with arts and crafts. From the vibrant Kashmiri kashidakari to Rajasthan's eye-catching blue pottery, each form, though made of simple fabric or mundane films, evokes a certain feeling of connection in its viewer. It is this curious quality of design, the way it subtly weaves its intricacy into our monotonous lives, that makes it so special, uniting humans through space and time. Haryana, Punjab, Delhi and Chandigarh, among others, represent an empire built on years and years of such meticulous artistic expression.
From the golden fields and gushing rivers of Punjab springs an art form that has been passed down from generation to generation. The phantoms of a story, a tale, whispered from mother to daughter repeatedly. The exquisite tradition of the Fulkari. Fulkari translates to floral work, but is so much more than just that. It is a window into the lives of the people of Punjab, their culture and the way it has evolved through the ages. Some say that Fulkari first found mention in texts like the Vedas and the Guru Granth Sahib, as well as regional folklore. There are even allegations that it has come down from Persia, where a similar craft called Gulkari is practiced. Whatever the case, it is now an art form that is woven so seamlessly into their lives that it is hard to imagine it another way. It is almost human itself, a living, breathing being that grows with the people. Gulkari piece is a testimony to the intrinsic connection we feel with each other, however short-lived it may be. From the Orni around the chieftain's head to the Darshan Dwar presented as sacred temple offerings, the art form is tuned harmoniously into everything the people do, especially the women. Marriages bring with them a flurry of excitement to the people, with girls taking on the bold endeavor of making a full-sized bag before they leave for their new homes.
फुलकारी असल च मैनू पसंद आ कह लो असल च मैनू बड़ी प्यारी लगती है फुलकारी क्योंकि वो रंग कितने ना कितने सानू जेड़ा डार्कनेस वो मोहब्बत दा प्रतीक आ फुलकारी
While the craft is gaining international recognition for its socio-political significance, Indian youth seems inclined to neglect this ancient tradition. The streets that once rang out with childlike laughter and the whispers of motherly love now face a forlorn future of silence and desertedness.
Wow, this is so new to me. I've been wearing clothes like these all my life, but I never realized just how much history is behind each of them.
Yeah, exactly. This was so much fun.
I agree.
Hey, do you want to keep reading some more? This is actually pretty interesting, don't you think?
Sure, there's plenty more in this book anyway. Look, the next craft is block printing.
Oh, that's that thing we did in class one time, isn't it? Yeah, I'd like to learn more about that too. Let's read just a few more pages then.
Amidst the sun-tinted sands of Rajasthan flows a vibrant burst of color in the wind, in the form of the cloth donned proudly by its people day after day. We talk of Indian fashion nonchalantly, painfully unaware of the rich history hidden quietly in our clothes, waiting patiently to be found.
In the back streets of Pakru, the outskirts of the Jaipur city, tradition still means a lot. The age-old art of block printing has been passed down to generations for at least 300 years now.
One comes across brands like Fab India and Enoki Daily, but few know that the technique these companies use can be dated back to Mughal times. Block printing, although seemingly a simple craft, weaves together the past and the present, a sturdy bridge connecting a people's history and future. The two main styles of block printing in Rajasthan are Bagru and Sanganer. Bagru is predominantly done on indigo or blue-based fabric with large geometrical motifs. Comparatively, Sanganer print pays much more attention to detail and is recognizable by its intricate flower motifs done on white or ivory backgrounds. This is due to the difference in the dyeing process since the Bagru region is scarce in water and uses a resist method to transfer the dye. While it is easier to transfer intricate dyes in Sanganer with its abundance in water resources. Modern Indian fashion is but an application of traditional styling to contemporary silhouettes, creating intricate clothing that stays true to its natural roots and yet flies free from any restraints. These clothes aren't mere cloth, but rather a bold and unapologetic expression of Rajasthani's artistic heritage. The whole process is a story in itself, crafted to perfection by the people of Rajasthan over the years. The blocks are first carved out of teak wood by the skillful hands of a craftsman. The fabric to be printed, pinned and stretched out on a table for the printing process to begin. Then comes the exciting part. The blocks are dipped in dye and pressed carefully onto the fabric again and again till the mesmerizing pattern finally begins to take shape. The work is done conscientiously over the course of what can span hours. Each masterpiece thus tenderly holds the essence of the artisan in the folds of its fabric, a fascinating mark of their labor.
Central India is perhaps where art has reached a peak of creativity and innovation. Apen art of Uttarakhand, done on red brick walls with rice paste, is not only beautiful, but also holds social and religious importance. The stark contrast of white against crimson serves as a symbol of the cultures and beliefs being passed down from generation to generation. Pachikari, for which Agra is famous, is a brilliant blend of Mughal influence and Indian ingenuity. Gond art, a tribal art form placed largely in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, has recently gained several international accolades for its simultaneous complexity and simplicity. Uttarakhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Uttar Pradesh, these are all proud crowns on the craft industry of India.
The Banarsi sari of Uttar Pradesh is distinctive in many ways and has long been viewed as the quintessential Hindu wedding sari. Ethnic Banarsi brocades are fine examples of the superb craftsmanship of Indian artisans. Rich in colors and patterns and interwoven painstakingly with threads of gold and silver, their ownership is considered prestigious and is a major status symbol.
बनारसी वस्त्र ये कला है। हमारे यहाँ कोई भी रॉ मटेरियल पैदा नहीं होता। हम सिल्क कहीं से मंगाते हैं, जरी कहीं से लेते हैं। हम तो सिर्फ अपनी कला उसमें जोड़ देते हैं, तभी ये बन पाता है। हाथों के कमाल को बनारसी कहते हैं। जकार्ड वीविंग सिस्टम है। पहले हम डिज़ाइन स्केच तैयार करते हैं और फिर इस ग्राफ को लेकर हम कार्ड पंक्चर किया जाते हैं। जो कार्ड हम पंच करते हैं उनके हर सुराख में डिज़ाइन छुपा हुआ होता है। ये जो ताना है ये जकार्ड की मदद से और कार्ड में जो डिज़ाइन पोशीदा है उससे ये उठता रहता है। और जब हम वेफ्ट क्रॉस फेंकते हैं तो वो कपड़ा भी बनाता है और डिज़ाइन भी बनाता है।
घंटा अगर काम करते हैं 6 इंच से ज्यादा हम काम नहीं कर पाते हैं, तो ये बहुत ही मेहनत का काम है, बहुत ही स्किल का काम है। तो उस विजुअल से लेकर और उसके हैंगर तक जाने तक इसमें बहुत से हाथ जुड़ते हैं। इन हाथों को मजबूत करने के लिए हम में से कुछ लोग हैं जो इसको संभाले हुए हैं।
Due to the expensive nature of the raw material, one sari can cost up to Rs 50,000 to Rs 60,000. However, recently there has been an all-India decline in the demand for the original silk saris due to the emergence of mass-produced Banarsi saris which have fewer exclusive materials and cost much cheaper. To preserve the glory of Banarsi saris, a few top designers in the country have come forward to work with different weaver clusters in Varanasi for showcases in national and international stores. However, these opportunities do come to a few and are far in between. Truth is, Banarsi weavers are struggling. The era of machine production has effectively removed from generations the ability to appreciate the laborious work of the artisan. Very few people realize what it actually means to weave a sari. Thanks to this presentation though, you watching at home are no longer one of those people. With the weight of your knowledge, your next actions are up to you. Next time, will you stop and appreciate the incredible talent that goes into each piece of every product that you are buying? Or will you bargain with the vendor for a few hundred rupees, a cheap sale to you? But the difference between being able to feed one's family and starving to countless others. Neither art nor its struggling artisans are confined to just these two zones of India. With our country's rich history, we have developed several unique populations within the outlines of our humble peninsula. Being surrounded by water, it is now time to move to the coast, the western coast to be specific.
Can you believe, with the modern technology, a lot of machine-made saris and textiles are available. They are cheap and in many colors.
But this can never replace the authentic one, of pieces which are exquisite and stand alone.
It is so important for us to bring out the craftsmen behind these pieces and the hands that have tirelessly created wonders.
And we so callously, without appreciating, put stock them in our wardrobes, without knowing the history behind it.
Come on, let's know more. I want to know as much as I can about this.
The western part of India is richly laden in terms of crafts and textiles. The lavish spread of different crafts like kutchi embroidery, lippan and worli attracts people who get enraptured by the stunning work presented by the craftsmen in the area. The growing industries of the western states have slowly eradicated the quaint, fragile craft works of artisans who had so delicately woven the secrets of their life and adorned the states with some great masterpieces. Be it Maharashtrian Pethni or Gujarati tribal art showcasing its folk tales or Daman and Diu ivory carving, all arise a swirl of desire among people to buy the gorgeous handicrafts that all depict a story of every hard-working artisan. A familiar chatter swells in the air as feet chase the trail of whispering women with eyes furrowed in concentration and lead to the by-lanes of boat spilling colours all over. While the women are busy tying knots in fabric, their murmured secrets quietly sneak into these tied bundles. Bandhani is not merely a fabric, it's a canvas of anonymous tales soaked in many colours and ensuring that the wearer is wrapped in the warmth of native emotions. Wow! Isn't this what you're wearing? Such vibrant colors. Come on, read some more. The Gujarati word bandhavun is derived from the Sanskrit word for tying, bandhan. The people engaged in producing designs and fabric because of tie-dyeing techniques are known as bandhej. The primordial craft of bandhani began around 5,000 years ago in the Indian states of Rajasthan and Gujarat. The Muslim Khatri community of Kutch is believed to be the first to use this form of dyeing. Archival facts confirm that in the 6th-7th century AD, bandhani cloth was depicted on the walls of Ajanta caves.
The artists examine the cloth carefully for quality and then mark the pattern after folding the cloth into four or more layers. Sometimes wooden blocks are used to mark the pattern on the cloth. Then the elaborate task of tying the knots is carried by the women folk who manage this along with their household chores. Men in the family also contribute to the process equally. The thread used for tying is usually plain cotton, mostly collected from industrial waste. And a single stole can have 4,000 to 5,000 knots. Interestingly, one can tie up to 700 knots in a single day. It is relatively easier to tie knots in silk or cotton fabric than wool, where the knots have to be reaffirmed by biting them with the teeth. Fast ties have made the process faster. These can be applied directly and have made the process much easier. Napsol dyes are also effective in cold solutions. This process is called lipai. The cloth is coloured from light to dark colour, and to remove excess dye, the dyed cloth is washed by local washermen. The ties of the folded bandhani cloth remain closed till they are sold, or are only opened at one corner to show the colour and design. For opening, the bandhani material is pulled crosswise, forcefully, so that all ties open up simultaneously, as all knots are tied in continuation and are rendered loose at the ends.
Although bandhani evokes a feeling of vibrance and richness in our hearts, the sad truth of its tying process bars one from using it. The dyeing process includes massive chemical discharge and unending pollution of water, which results in the death of aquatic life, ruining of soils and poisoning of drinking water. One can only find consolation in the fact that both the government and private organizations are constantly working to reduce the pollution caused by the textile industries. Since the most pressing problem faced by the art form is the convolution of chemical dyes it uses in the present, it becomes necessary to look at its history, where a plethora of natural elements such as flowers, barks and berries were used to produce its flamboyant colors. Rebuilding the art by going back to the roots of this longest tradition could palliate the environmental cost of the process today. This provides us with a glimmer of hope to preserve this wonderful textile of bandhani.
Well, that was a lot more than just a few pages.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Not that I didn't enjoy it. This has all been quite enlightening for me, in a way. Like, I always knew, of course, that there were real people making all of these products. I just never quite comprehended for some reason until I actually saw all the different processes and the methods and difficulties these artisans face. I feel kind of bad now for how indifferent, as rather, all of us have acted in the past.
Don't feel bad. I mean, at least we took the pains to learn and know about it now. We read about quite a lot today, didn't we?
Wait, why are you talking like we're done reading?
What do you mean?
There's still all of South India left to cover, as well as the northeastern states. We'll be here a long time.
While we're still on the coastline, we might as well talk of some of the other states near the sea. That's right, folks. We're talking about Southern India. Strap in, because we're going the Kanyakumari route.
Green landscapes, enormous domes touching the skyline, and traces of royal legacies. The South is celebrated for its rich and multifaceted cultural history. Its diligently crafted architecture holds historical importance, and its rich cultural heritage is deep-rooted in the lives of people here. The state patrons make awe-inspiring crafts such as Kalamkari, Pidri, Channapatna toys, and more. And of course, the handloom from South is globally recognized for its distinct weaving style and the life that it brings to the fabric it makes. After all, who hasn't used the term South cotton? Born from the art of storytelling, Kalamkari is an age-old craft dating back to 3000 BC. It arises from the Persian word Kalamkari. Kalam as in pen and Kari as in craftsmanship. Mughals promoted this art in the Golconda and Coromandel province, where skillful craftsmen known as Kulamkars used to practice this art. These well-known fabrics were once traded to Europe and the Gulf against gold. Ample production of cotton fabric in southern India has ensured the supply of the raw materials to both Srikalahasti and Michilipatnam and led to the growth of Kalamkari. The tools that are necessary for Kalamkari are kalam, kuchi, literally translating to a pen or even a brush. To create design contours, artists use a bamboo or date palm stick. Natural dyes are made of raw materials like vegetables. Kalamkari maggam, another essential tool, is a wooden frame that secures the cloth on both ends while painting. The cloth is boiled in copper vessels using dry flowers, barks, leaves and roots to give it a tinge of color and shade. In recent years, with increased interaction between states, block printing has been introduced to this method to make the process of creating intricate Kalamkari patterns both faster and more economically viable, though faster still means dozens of hours put into one piece of cloth.
Spankari means work like that. Its original name was Vratapani. Savrata means writing, Pane means work. See, originally we used to export these kalamkaris to European countries since 13th, 12th century like that. So there are more than 2,000 people are there in Kalahasti. And it became very famous in India also.
கடுக்கா பிஞ்சு காட்டிலலாம் கிடைக்கும். அங்கேருந்து எடுத்துட்டு வந்து ஊற வச்சு அப்புறம் பேஸ்ட் பண்ணணும். அந்த பேஸ்ட்டை கவு மில்கில் நல்லா மிக்ஸ் பண்ணிவிட்டு நம்ம வாஷ் பண்ண அந்த காடால ஊற வைக்கணும். ஒரு 1 hour, 1.5 மணி நேரம் ஊற வைக்கணும்.
The fabric is washed under running water to get rid of the odor of buffalo milk. The fabric likewise is washed 20 times and dried under the sun.
புளி மரத்தை கொம்பு கடிக்கும். அந்த கொம்பு எத்தனை வந்து ஃபயர் பண்ணிட்டான்னா அதில் வந்து குச்சி மாதிரி பொக்கு கோல் வரும். அந்த கோல் நம்மளுக்கு பென்சில் இன மாதிரி வேலை செய்யும். அந்த எந்தெந்த இடத்துல எதாவது வேணும்னா ஸ்கெச்சிங் போட்டு ரெடி ஆகிடுச்சு. இந்த கலர் பிளாக் கலர் அதில் அப்ளை பண்ணும்.
Craftsman has been learning this art from his father since the age of 13 and has carried it to new horizons. He received the Padma Shri in 2008 in recognition of his contribution to Kalamkari art. M.B. Rumal, an eminent Kalamkari craftsman, quoted, "The canvas of our lives may be tattered, but we believe that our skills hold the promise of a better tomorrow." And this powerful statement is a testament for all Indians to buy and promote the unique work of Kalamkari, which is made with profound care by skillful artisans. It is quite interesting to see the way how so many of our perceptions of what art or talents is defined as is heavily influenced by standards of Western art, and something that we should also perhaps reflect on. History will never be erased, nor it should be, but there are ultimately two kinds of independence, from politics sure, but also from the influence that stretches on decades after the deed is supposedly done with. The next zone covers states which have played large roles in the part of history, and which have also produced some of the proudest artists of our country. Allow us to show you the crafts of the next zone, Eastern India.
The rich cultural heritage of these states is depicted in the intricate crafts of this region, and the dexterity and the sense of artistry of the locals are reflected in each craft. The eastern states consist of Bihar, Bengal, Jharkhand, and Orissa. Some of the crafts found here are Madhubani, Katwa applique, tribal jewelry, Ikat, West Bengal handloom, Kantha, Batik, and Sheetalpatti. However, it is the arts of Dokra that has gained foremost importance here. If an image has to be made, it must be made of wax first. Vishnu Samhita, 5th century AD. Under clouds of smoke emanating from earthen lamps, amid battered clay fragments and wax coils, a brass sculpture is in making. Though finishes are raw, the expressions frozen and the metal hollow, the sculpture has a gravity of emotional and spiritual value, with forms almost verbal, narrating stories that its creator intended to. Long before faster and cheaper methods of making products came into being, the traditional metalsmith tribes of Bengal, Dokra Damar, used to carve on wax to make bell metal sculptures. They were nomads, traveling from village to village, fixing up old utensils and selling their lost wax brass figurines. Their detailed depictions of gods and goddesses, intricate lamps, bells, and ornaments were greatly revered. The lost wax method of casting a sculpture was first practiced during the Indus Valley era around 2500 BC, and the dancing girl is one of the first examples of this technique. In India, the ancient scholarly work Shilp Shastra goes into the detail of metalworking with alloys and casting of a wide range of utilities from daily use items, sacred artworks, and architectural products. Here, metalwork largely derives its inspiration from religion. Before any artisan sits to make the figure, he prays for guidance from the son of Lord Vishwakarma, Tvastram, who is said to be an expert in metal alloys. Artisans use a mixture of beeswax, raisins from the tree Damara orientalis, and nut oil to make a soft dough. This mixture is passed through sieves to attain homogeneous thickness and then rolled into long strands. The coiling effect gives Dokra figurines their characteristic feature. Further, ornamentations are done by carving on the wax. Fine riverbed soil and coal dust mixture form the first layer on the wax model, as this mixture brilliantly takes on the textures and shapes of the wax, resulting in a perfect inner wall of the mold. The second coat of red soil and rice husk mixture is applied to it. This helps in toughening of the outer surface. When the model is complete, two holes are made at one end and the wax sticks are put into these holes to provide a passage for the molten inner wax and air bubbles upon heating. The piece is sun-dried and then fired in the bhatti, traditional kiln. The wax melts and comes out of the mold. When the entire wax has come out of the model, molten brass is poured in through the same holes. The mold is then put to cool off and the brass inside solidifies on its own. When the artisan begins to chip off the clay mold, the brass within can be seen having taken the desired form. Swami Narayan riding an elephant, Radha Krishna with their love gaze, Goddess Lakshmi are a few frequently executed themes. Throughout this presentation, we have covered several different art forms of various different regions, differing as much as in style, in technique, as they do in geographical features. However, while the art forms we have talked about till now may have been mostly familiar to at least the majority of you, there are some art forms in India that are more popular than others, and certain groups of people in our country which we've alienated within our own nation. Some of the upcoming art forms then might be completely new to you, which is why we urge you to pay closer attention, bend forward, notice all the details. After all, that is the beauty of handmade craft.
For centuries, the Northeast has been a medley of various cultures, which is reflected in the rich array of arts and crafts one can find here. The Northeast region comprises of 8 states: Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, Tripura, and Sikkim. The rainy tangled forests and hills are home to countless exquisite handloom and crafts like Longpi pottery, bamboo, and cane crafts. Eri silk. Silk has always been the fabric of emperors and the aristocracy, so coveted in ancient times that the trade route along which it travelled from Asia to Europe was named after it. Traditional silk is associated with violence, but for those who can't do without their silks, Eri silk provides an alternative. It is also a variant called Ahimsa silk, or fabric of peace. Traditionally spun in Assam, Meghalaya, and other areas in the Northeast India, Eri silk fabrics don't harm the silkworm or its pupae. Eri silk is made from naturally open-ended cocoons. When it is ready to emerge, the mature moth does not have to pierce the cocoon, thus breaking the natural silk encasing it. Eri silk is a rich legacy of the textile culture of Assam. Rural and tribal women here have been processing, spinning, and weaving it as a part of their daily lives. The term Eri silk is derived from the Assamese word era, which means castor. Also, the humid climate in Northeast India is very favorable for the Eri culture. The silk is used by the indigenous people of Assam to make chadars for their use. but the market for Eri silk is gradually expanding. Due to its unique thermal properties, the fabric remains warm in winter and cool in summer. Apparel made from Eri silk can be worn all year round. Stoles, shawls, saris and home furnishing products are being fashioned out of Eri silk. Such stoles and shawls are dyed using natural elements such as lac, tea waste, onion skin and turmeric. You can explore a stunning range of Eri silk stoles made by artisans from Assam. It is amazing how such a tiny but unique creature is working its way out of Assam's indigenous culture and into the closets and homes of people across India. As concerns for sustainability and environmental consciousness regarding clothes and other products increase by the day, you'll find that many of the traditional crafts of India employ methods that both reduce zero waste and do not encroach on the surrounding habitats in a way which might destroy the ecosystem. There are many things the Industrial Revolution may be lauded for, but everything has a price. The price of convenience is our traditions, culture, and also the very land we live on. Comparatively, the extra rupees one might pay for something handmade doesn't seem like much, does it? In the face of fierce competition from modern fast-paced and cheaper cloth production methods, as well as major shifts to more Western styles of clothing, and just overall disregard for the manual labor as well as artistic prowess that goes into the making of traditional handicrafts, artisans today that are continuing with such art forms seem almost to be trying to fit into a world that has already filled up their place. Not only are the materials required for their crafts hard to acquire due to the ever-changing ecosystems of the country, they also do not get enough support or subsidies, which should have been a given, as not only do they preserve our heritage, they are also capable of generating massive amounts of unemployment, which is one of the biggest issues India's youth faces today, as well as strengthening the local economies, which would further promote organic development in the more remote and rural parts of India. In the past 2 years, they are also facing a problem which is much more unprecedented. Right along with the rest of the world, the pandemic. The impact that the COVID-19 pandemic has had on these cottage industries is devastating. India's handicrafts have not only lost markets to sell their products in, they have also lost droves and droves of workers, either to the virus itself or to the consequences of it. This is why it is so important, especially now, to support these crafts. When presented with a choice between an international name brand and the weaver across the street, why don't we choose what's closer to home? That being said, as environmental consciousness increases, so does cultural consciousness. The world is going through massive shifts right now. The scales, which have been tilted predominantly to one side for a good part of the past few centuries, are slowly being tugged at and righted. There is still a long way to go, but cultural assimilation and Americanization in everything from media to language is being recognized and actively fought against today. As across the globe, ethnic appreciation replaces Western, specifically the USA-focused trends. This is especially true in India and has been reflected here more and more by the day. While it's true that the indigenous textile scene may provide a bleak outlook in many ways, there is a lot being done in the field to ensure a revival of these designs, as well as ensuring local artisans have a more stable livelihood. A very prominent brand working in this area that we have all probably heard of, if not shopped from before, is Fab India. Fab India is a homegrown brand which has upheld artisan welfare as its core essence and continues to draw strength of rural craftspeople and provide patronage to local artisan communities, from the extensive art of block printing to the unequaled finesse of Banarsi weaving. Retailers like Anokhi, Kilol and many others are doing much of the same work, and organizations like Dastakar promote Indian handicrafts as well. Indian styles are increasingly being considered fashionable, and today's youth are doing much to incorporate tradition into their daily wear. Several designers like Ikaya and Sabyasachi even adapt some forms to fit today's popular tastes, although of course the dominant Western influences still remain.
That was such an eye-opening and inspirational session.
I totally agree with you, and there is still so much to explore.
We learned so much today.
Yeah, I mean, of course, there was so much more that we learned about the history of these crafts and the struggle of the artisans and everything. But even just looking at textile, I had never realized just how common it is to everyone, yet so different and unique at the same time.
Exactly. Textile is truly the one thing that both unites us as humans, yet allows us individuality within that unity. Like, even in just our country, there are so many different forms, and all of them are unique and hold so much potential.
The next time I'm buying new clothes like this, I will make sure to stop, pause, and appreciate all the hard work that goes behind this. It's so simple to just add the label handmade to something without much thought. But we seem to forget about the hands that made them. It's still mind-blowing to me how meticulous someone has to be to do all this.
I agree. From now on, whenever I see a shawl or a sari, look at the designs on the cutlery in the kitchen drawers, or even the carvings on a doorknob, I will look beyond just what it is and see what it really represents, and what perhaps would have gone in the making of it.
You know what? I think you and I should make a collective pledge of some sorts to always try and support local artisans.
Yes, we should. There are so many products we tend to buy from large, glamorous stores that we could get instead of much better quality too from local sellers.
We should do as much as we possibly can to preserve these age-long crafts. They've lasted through centuries. It would be a shame if we were the generation who let them slip through our grip.
Well, as much as I'd like to stay on, it's almost time to go.
We don't have much time left, do we? I'll put this away then. Let's go.
When it comes to Vellum's relationship with these crafts, our art and design electives remain popular among students from all classes, where they're not only sensitized to the different art forms of India by learning about their methods, techniques, and rich history in a class from a textbook, but also practice them as well.
From Banthani to block printing, Lippan and Eppan, and even the South's Kanchipuram, the students here have weaved together the history of this everlasting heritage from all over India, and not just imitated it, but also made it their own.
The appreciation this then creates within each student is what really led to the presentation we just saw. We hope that now, at the end of our journey, that same appreciation will transfer over to you as well.
Stop, pause, and appreciate the finer details of life. And when the time comes, extend your support to the ones that painstakingly make them.